Welcome to Off the Press, the program where we take a look at all our national dailies, if you like, the newspaper review, and make sense of it. To dissect the newspapers this morning with me in the studio is our policy analyst, Ifi Oji.
Thank you, Amaka.
Good to have you this morning.
Likewise.
And of course, our very own political analyst, Alesta Wilcox.
I'm already smiling. Thanks.
Yes, because you are very own. It's always good to have
it's
you.
It's nice to share the stage with Ifi.
Yes, I know. Right. Favorite Likewise. People. All right, let's have this conversation this morning. So we have the Punch, the Vanguard, the Nation, and this day to look at this morning. But maybe we should begin with the Vanguard. If it's okay, we would proceed with the Vanguard. And the big story is insurgency. Depressed soldier shoots seven and kills himself. It's really sad to begin with that sad story. And at the top there, you see something on Bayelsa. No force on earth can reverse our verdict. That's according to the Supreme Court. That story is on page 12. GDP growth rate still largely low. That's according to Ban on page 10. And then we have a picture story here. Yesterday was Ash Wednesday, which is the beginning of the Lenten season for Catholics. And there's a picture story of protest against insecurity as we see them all decked in black in solidarity to mourn all those who have passed on and all the insecurity that's going on in the country. That story is on the front page. And UCH medical consultants down tools over mandatory PhD certificate. That's an interesting development there on page 11. And no subsidy from federal government since privatization, according to discourse on page 10. And we have something on Edo State 2020. Security agencies worry over spate of violence in Edo State on page 12. And Catholic bishops decry federal government's failure to deal with terrorists on page 9. That's about it on the Vanguard newspaper. So let's begin with, from Alesta. It's been a long time. We saw you here. So which one is catching your attention this morning?
Well, the rape of the moon being the Supreme Court position. Mm-hmm. I think despite how painful it could be to some of us who found that judgment a bit worrisome with respect to the Bayelsa gubernatorial election, but the angle in which the politicians are beginning to want to take our Supreme Court to ridicule leaves much to be desired. Mm. And so for the Supreme Court to come out hard yesterday on that new lexicon that wanted to have in our judicial system, calling for review of every political. In fact, if something different has happened yesterday, I tell you, the Supreme Court judges will have run away from the court because there will have been barrage of, okay, must review this immorality. So for them to have asserted
themselves,
their position themselves and say, look, this court is final. And any judgment that comes, no matter how flawed, no matter how bad, no matter how you might not see it as anything, it is final.
In fact,
So right now they have established that. So the only caveat I will put there is this: the Supreme Court in every country is the constitution writing body of that country. Mm-hmm. It is what the Supreme Court says the constitution is, that it is. So that now puts on them a higher level of responsibility in arriving at that decision, because knowing fully well that whatever decision that they arrive at will no longer be challenged on this earth. It's only maybe when they go to meet God or when there is anything, when they go to see God, Baba God, that they will answer if that decision was wrong or politically motivated. So since I see them as the constitution writing body of the country, because some of their pronouncement in the past has given vent to part of the constitutions of this country. And that is why all worldwide. So the responsibility on them now is to live above board. Any politically minded, any politically exposed judge in the Supreme Court need to be recusing him or herself from certain cases. Because the name of Justice Mary Odili was consequently mentioned in that judgment because of her marital relationship with a PDP top stalwart. So now everybody needs to be watchful.
In the
interest of justice, if you're a politically exposed judge in any way, in any form, in any, no matter how minute, you must recuse yourself from any case that has to do with politics. so that the court will maintain its dignity, its sanctity, and its independence.
And justice will be served.
Justice will be served and seem to be served.
All right. Okay.
If just to add to what he said, he's right. I agree with him totally. Well, I won't go as far as say that the constitution writing body, but they definitely give the interpretation to where how we perceive the constitution.
By the way, you're a legal practitioner. So I recall that. Yes.
Yeah,
so
she's
giving all the.
In construct, I understand. Yes. I understand what you're trying to say. The interpretation of the law as found in the Supreme Court mm-hmm. will shape obviously our own perception of what that law is and what the law is. I guess in that sense, I guess that's correct. Mm-hmm. In terms of also the being politically exposed, I agree with him as well. I also feel that if you look at that, an interview, I think Ruth Bader Ginsburg gave mm-hmm. a couple of months ago. I can't remember in what context, but she explained the process and. It was quite obvious that even halfway during the interview that it was almost a very special moment mm-hmm. for her to be interviewed in that kind of forum. I think it was a political show. Mm-hmm. So it is so sacrosanct. It's so sacred rather mm-hmm. to have and make sure that they are more or less shielded from all the ongoings mm-hmm. Outside the realm of what their main mandate is.
So their judgment is not colored, so to
exactly.
speak, by anything.
Exactly.
All
precisely.
Right. Okay. We'll move away from that story and
look at the insurgents, the soldier.
Okay. Yeah. The press soldier shoots seven and kills himself.
Quite unfortunate. I think the army is investigating mm-hmm. really what could have led to that. But again, don't rule out, like you said, like the paper reported the press.
Hmm.
Yeah, when soldiers are in the theater of war, a lot comes to play. Even the American soldiers had it. Most soldiers are in the war. In fact, I will praise our soldiers. The resilience of our black nature in holding on to so many things in the face of poor equipment, in the face of every poor condition, they still held out to keep. That is why each time I talk about the insurgents and the way the reportage goes, I get very angry.
Mm.
We don't give enough credit to our men,
mm-hmm.
our soldiers. Rather, we elevate the activity of the insurgents far above the activities and the successes of the soldiers. Mm. So we owe them a duty of responsibility to keep propagating those things they are doing and keep encouraging them to do more. Not when they will kill 20 insurgents, will not report it. When the soldiers kill one person, we blow it out of proportion. You know, so that I think reportage will help.
Mm-hmm.
I know that they are going through a lot. So I don't know what causes this man to go berserk and shoot his colleagues. I don't know what causes it.
Yeah.
But let the army come up with their report. Mm-hmm. But if it has to do with depression and something different needs to be done to make our men and women in uniform battle ready and able to carry on the battle.
No, if I may add to what Alexa has just said, I agree with him. Again, we don't address the issue of mental health in Nigeria at all. It's one of the big things that, and especially in that particular area, because that they are frontline with, and they face death and they confront death on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to make sure that these guys are up, that are in complete, not only just physical condition. We see them go to India, wherever else, to do all the trainings. But who is actually looking at their well-being, mental well-being?
Yeah.
And I would not be surprised if it's post-traumatic stress disorder, mm-hmm. which is very common among soldiers.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we got finally. So unless they do something about that, we may, unfortunately, these sort of things may keep happening. So we need to really take it seriously and not just give lip service and mouth service to it, which is what we are typically used to doing.
Because it was on this, you know, here in Plus TV Africa, I think just a couple of days ago, we were talking about the welfare of, you know, military personnel. Mm. And it's all of these put together.
Yes.
If we only say, you know, we hear the news of more equipment, you can buy equipment, but if the person who is to handle equipment is not even sound.
I think you're referring to the police, the police Inspector General's comment.
No,
I agree with you.
Don't add up. To be checked. All right. Ify, let's still come back to you on your favorite GDP
above the masthead.
Yes. Talk about money. Tell us.
I am definitely above the masthead kind of person. Well, yeah. So looking at, I mean, everybody is we are aware of the success that we recorded recently.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was even the Nigerian Bureau of Statistics that gave us this information about our GDP growth. So to 2.5%, we've been in an incessant recession since 2016, I believe. And
scampering for money everywhere.
Yeah, well, I mean, we need the money. And I think this is meant to help us sort of boost even our own public relations, for lack of a better word, amongst investors. Apparently, the Manufacturers Association of Nigeria, the president was interviewed, I think, was it yesterday or the day before, and they asked him certain questions, especially around trade and around the economy. And this is what he said. And he actually makes a very good point. One of the first things you learn in microeconomics is that, yes, GDP is very important, but what is even more crucial is GDP per capita.
Yeah.
And per capita takes into account, is a factor that takes into account the population of the nation. Mm-hmm. I know there are a lot of speculation about what our actual population is in definitive terms. I don't remember the last time we did a census.
I don't remember. I don't
know what I mean. It shows that I'm exposing our ages right now. So what I'm making really is that ultimately, yes, GDP is important, and it's obviously a big win for Nigeria as we're moving forward and trying to get this money. But ultimately, we need to also temper that with the idea of it being GDP per capita, taking account the general population of Nigeria.
All right. Thank you so very much for that intervention. I think in the interest of time, we will very quickly move to the Punch newspaper. That's the paper up for review. It will be put up very soon. Now, the same story there, 2.55% GDP growth below population surge, says man. And that story is on page 30, which Ife has thankfully explained to us. Now, 2019 debt services gulped 2.1 trillion naira, according to investigation. That story is on page 27, already displayed there on your screens. And then PDP holds emergency NEC meeting today on page 20. Now, Bayelsa, Supreme Court refuses to sack Diri, awards 60 million naira cost. That story is on page 2. And then Catholic bishops to government. Failure to arrest culprits shows federal government's insincerity on killings. That story is on page 9. And then we have a picture story of the gridlock on the Lagos-Ibadan Expressway on Wednesday. That's just yesterday. You can see different sides of that place. Three Ekiti teachers arrested for allegedly raping pupils. This is not good at all. That story is on page 5. Three of them, really. And then Tiamu's car vandalized in police station. Father of slain Remo star player says that's on page 43. That's, I think, is the story of the SARS. And the thugs attack Kwara APC chair as crisis deepens. And page 21. Five kidnappers bag life imprisonment in Ondo. That's progress, if you ask me. That's the reason, page 29. And soldiers beat up Lagos officials for seizing hawkers' wares on pages 4 and 5. And troop fighting Boko Haram kills 4 colleagues, injures others on page 21. Alesta, let's come to you.
Yeah.
You seem to be looking at that gridlock thing.
Yes, Okay. I didn't put a comment on the GDP issue.
Yes.
Yes. When looking into population, I think we need to do something about our population growth.
What do you want us to do about it? We should
look.
What do you mean?
I'm working with a group that is talking about maternal and child care, and that has exposed me to the rot of to the kind of senseless patriot that we have in this country. It's appalling. And when we continue in this trend, I'm lost as to what can be done. Sincerely, when we continue in this trend, no matter the GDP growth we have, it will be wiped off. Because when the population keeps growing at an alarming state, and the unfortunate thing is, everybody seems to be careless about it. Even those who are supposed to control, you've already had 3 children and you keep wanting to have more and more and more and more.
But you say you're African.
Look, go to Ghana. You can find, you can search for pregnant women in Ghana with a micro. You may not find in a whole day.
That's,
come to
that's
Nigeria.
Extreme.
I'm telling you. No, I'm telling you.
We will check.
Go and check. You might walk the whole market of in Ghana. You might not find a pregnant woman.
We have a Ghanaian, we can actually confirm. But
come to Nigeria. Every street, every door, as you're giving your gate, you are seeing big Tommies pulling you up and down. And the question is, everyone must have their own children. Yes, I agree. But since we need to check it. We just need to check it. Now, talking about the gridlock, I don't know what really is happening with our traffic management authorities. they seem not to be on the top of your game every time. Every time you have this. Every time you have this, what is happening?
But who has also noticed that there are a lot of last man, you know, those people on the way.
Doing what? Go to and see the last man. They are there making phone call or looking for who to catch or something. Something just needs to be done. I don't know, but something just needs to be done.
Should
we come back to the odd and even number or something? You have removed all the bikes and the keke on the way, which you said will create a free flow traffic. Now that seems to have compounded the problem, because now you find all manner of cars on the road. Those who hit that door could have used keke or bike, especially these e-hailing bikes companies. Yeah. Those who could have patronized and used them. You've cut that off and said you want to create sanity in Lagos. Now look at, in fact, since this month of February, it has been hectic. You spend 3 hours. I live in Onikman. You spend 3 hours to get to Lekki. Spend 4 hours going back. Just within that thing, imagine those who are living far away, and people are stranded on the road. So, I don't know the kind of policy making our leaders always put up across, but I think something needs to be done.
If you do want to intervene.
I mean, we've spoken about this before, especially when it relating to the vehicular density in Lagos State specifically. And I know that one of the times that the governor of Lagos was trying to address this issue before this whole crisis.
Keke ban.
Yeah, the keke ban and the keke ban crisis. It is a crisis in real terms. One of the things he had mentioned was that, okay, they would like to build more roads. But I mean, if you're going to build more roads, you really need to make sure that the roads are built before you make these things more difficult.
They always put the cart before the horse.
That is nice.
The other day they are saying they are bringing out boats, and I'm like,
yeah,
and I'm like, boats to from where Ikorodu to Marina, that's all. So how did the boat get to Tamil Savage and to other places? Sometimes policy, the way they do their policy, sometimes I begin to wonder, do these people really come out from their houses sane to get to the offices to start doing some of these policies?
It's quite unfortunate.
Something drastic and urgent to be done to correct the Lagos. Maybe we'll go back to odd and even number. That we were abandoned in the 80s. Maybe we'll go back to it.
It makes
sense. At least there'll be carpooling. People will have to carpool. I know in my office, once it's a certain time, everybody that works there, regardless of whether or not you have anything active to do, you have to leave because you have people that you're going home with.
We also carpool here, really, of trying to. Maybe more people should do that. All right, I just noticed that I skipped this. Nigeria has the highest TB infection cases in Africa. That's according to World Health Organization. That story is on page.
They will always give us bad
scary
reports. I don't have the statistics, but they will always want to give us bad reports. I don't believe it.
And then the Fed, no, you can't outrightly say.
I don't believe it. I'm positive about the country. I don't believe it.
No, until you take a look and see the figures. Maybe it's something we need to pay attention to also as a nation. The federal government awards 29.2 billion naira road contracts to Niger Republic borders. What are your thoughts?
Okay, I think this is actually a direct response to the criticism they've got from the West African states regarding their lack of activity in trying to open up Nigeria's borders. They've had a lot of, especially with the ban, with the import ban.
Closure
of the border. Thank you. So I think this is their way of saying, okay, we hear you guys, we hear our neighbors, we want to actually address this issue and open up these routes for them.
So what's happened to the Semebadagri road?
They don't have a choice. By July 1, they're going to have to open up those roads. They have made a commitment.
Come what's me.
So we're just counting down those
things. But the road is still very terribly, in a terrible shape. I mean, of that West African trunk line, only the Nigerian section is terrible. By the time you cross into Cotonou, it's smooth sailing till you get to.
So the problem is the Nigerian.
Smooth sailing. Even Benin Republic, Togo, Ghana, they've all done their road smooth sailing up to Cote d'Ivoire.
So our problem is
just
our problem.
The same to my two parts. It's just a problem. Nigeria needs to wake up. I don't know.
Okay. Now, while he's still asleep, let's go to while he's preparing to wake up. Let's quickly take a look at the Nation newspaper. We don't have much time. Tinubu didn't turn down Akeredolu. He'll honor invitation on page 41. Coronavirus, Chinese quarantined in Lagos on page 5. Corporal corporal kills 4 soldiers and self in Bruno and 2 others injured. That story is on page 5. Again, we're talking about the mental health and state of the men in uniform. This Coast tackle minister over power supply claims TCN not capable of transmitting 7,000 megawatts. It's a shame. That story is on the front page. It's continued on page 41. And one feared dead in Pupils Ibadan clash and repentant Boko Haram men back on page 41. Supreme Court, our decision final, no matter how anybody feels. And Bayelsa verdict fine of all ages. Court slams fine on Afe and Olanipekun. That story is on the front page. And North's governors set to end almajiri and street begging. That's on the front page. And residents relief tanker fire ordeal on Lagos Ibadan Road on page 9. You can see a picture story. And the Pope to Catholics disconnect from social media and TVs at length.
The Holy Father is really asking for something.
He's asking for
that's a really lot. Big.
Dear Holy Father.
But if I could just look at the discos and that issue, that is a really big issue right now because it's been going on since, for the last 4, 5 months, 6 months. And just to really just add to what was said earlier on, I think a few weeks ago in this program as well, it's now obvious why Siemens was brought forward. Siemens put forward a report trying to basically analyze the state of the nation, basically in terms of power supply. And I think the discos are really fighting back. So any kind of threat to put Siemens as the main distribution company in Nigeria is not being sitting well at all with the Association of Nigeria Distribution Companies. So they've basically said that they deserve to have some kind of control. Subsidy.
Okay.
Some subsidy. I mean, look at, last we were talking about the ECA account, that's the excess crude account, and how it's been depleted. And then we know that a lot of that money was used to try and, a bulk of the money was used to try and tackle all subsidies. So why, I guess that's a fair question to ask. Why can't the same be done for power? Because power is so crucial. And there's a direct correlation between power supply and infrastructure with economic growth.
Yes. I
think they have a valid point, especially in that regard.
For me, the discourse should be, in fact, they should be more heavy on them. They are criminals.
The discourse.
Okay.
They are the criminal of the nation.
Now that
they have pegged it, yes. They are the criminal of the nation because they have refused to invest.
Okay.
They refused to meter.
But the meter solution, I mean, there's a solution. The NERC now says if you've not been metered before or if your meter is not reading, you pay a flat rate of 1,800.
So that's a good way to start. That will put them in check. Because right now, they decide not to meter people. They just give you estimated bill. In fact, I have had a running battle with them. In fact, that news makes me very happy. And I'm going to photocopy anywhere I see.
Laminate it and put it on your door.
I don't know if Siemens is going to be the solution we need for Nigeria.
I don't know about the Siemens solution.
Yes, but sincerely speaking,
those who are handling the power architecture, as well as the distribution, they are people that do not have any experience in power management.
I don't think that's true.
Most of them, I mean, who are the owners of the company?
Okay, we'll take this argument elsewhere. Unfortunately, this is the much we can take. Thank you so very much, Alesta Wilcox. You're here today. Thank you for your time. And Ife, of course, it's always good to have both
always
of you.
Always a pleasure, Amaka.
It's my pleasure to have you.
Makes sense. And this is where we are going to call it a wrap. Please stay with us tomorrow, the same time, 8:30, here on Plus TV Africa, where we do the same review the newspaper. I am Amaka Okoye, saying have yourselves a great day ahead of you.